After the Meiji Restoration of 1868, certain perceptible changes occurred at the political level of Japan. Such changes served as the background of the Meiji Constitution of 1889. According to Harold Vinock, the Meiji Constitution of 1889 owed much to the Charter Oath of 1868. Through this Charter Oath, the Meiji rulers, immediately after assuming the political power, decided to form a council for open discussion of the problems confronting the nation, but no such measures had been adopted for a long time. But in the 1870s and in the 1880s, new kind of political movements came on the surface in the political history of Japan, and among these, most important was the movement for freedom and people's rights. This movement gave rise to two fundamental questions and posed some serious challenge before the Meiji government. How a new political structure should be formed after the Meiji Restoration? And the second question was that who would be the participants in this new system, in this new political structure? In fact, the politically aware citizens were very eager to write a document, and that was the constitution, and they felt that this document or a new constitution could give answer to these questions. In about 1872-73, the Meiji rulers also accepted the demand for a constitution. In fact, demand for a constitution became the rallying cry of many non-government and anti-government organizations as well. When demand for the constitution started, it at first began at the local level, but soon it got a national dimension, and the movement for a new constitution in fact gave rise to a civil liberties and democratic rights movements in Japan, which took a very significant dimension in the history of Japan. But before going into that, we have to say something about a violent insurgency which the Meiji government faced just within a decade of the Meiji Restoration. This revolt was known as the Satsuma Rebellion. Saigo Takamori was a very important leader of the Satsuma clan, who played a very vital role in organizing the Meiji Restoration, and he was a very important member of the Meiji government. Saigo Takamori debated that Japan should adopt a very aggressive foreign policy and Japan should invade Korea. But his opponents in the government insisted on internal reconstruction of Japan, and they felt that attacking Korea at that particular moment would be harmful for Japan, and not only that, they thought it to be a very immature decision, as they wanted that internal reconstruction for the new Japan was a must. Saigo Takamori immediately left the government and organized the violent Satsuma revolt in January 1877. A bloody campaign followed for months, but ultimately Saigo's rebellion was brutally crushed by the Meiji government. In September 1877, Saigo Takamori, along with his followers, had been killed, and the Saigo's Satsuma rebellion came to an end. In fact, Saigo's rebellion was a futile effort to return to the old order. John Fairbank, an outstanding historian on East Asia, rightly observed that Saigo's defeat spelled the end of the old order in the political history of Japan. But almost simultaneously with this Satsuma rebellion, another new kind of political movement occurred in Japan. In fact, Saigo's rebellion was a reactionary movement and expression of certain ultra-nationalist demands, whereas the new movement was a demand for greater democracy, which was known as the popular rights movements in Japan. And in organizing the popular rights movements, Itagaki Taisuke of Tosha clan played the most important role. Itagaki was also a member of the government, But in 1873, he left the Meiji government to give leadership to the popular rights movement. In 1874, he formed an organization known as the Public Party of Patriots. The Public Party of Patriots, that is in 1874, sent a memorial on the establishment of a representative assembly to the Japanese government at Tokyo. In 1875, the organization was renamed as Society of Patriots, and then it became League for Establishment of a National Assembly. The major demand of the organization of Itagaki Taisuke was to get a national representative assembly, and the demand for a national assembly or a representative body became very important. But the Meiji rulers agreed to give a constitution, but they were still reluctant, still hesitant to grant any national assembly to the Japanese citizens. In the meantime, the movement for a national assembly also gathered momentum in Japan, and popular rights movement became very intensive throughout Japan. In the rural and urban areas, many secret societies had been formed. Along with these secret societies, some study centers had also been formed. In no time, these study centers became the nerve centers of the popular rights movement in Japan. These groups emerged as the independent groups, and they demanded two things: a constitution and a national assembly. The importance and magnitude of the activities of such groups was so much that two most important universities had developed out of these study groups. Keio University and Waseda University, in fact, had been established from such local study groups. But still, we should remember that the popular rights activists and the supporters of the popular rights movements in Japan formed a very microscopic minority as far as entire Japanese population was concerned. The political issue, which was most intensely debated by the popular rights activists, was the power and position of the king. What would be the power and position of the Japanese empire? It was a much debated issue. In fact, a very little number of Japanese, even Japanese intellectuals and political rights activists, they had been impressed by the French Revolution and its declaration of the rights of man and citizen. Andrew Gordon, a very recent historian, has very aptly remarked that there was no republican in Meiji Japan in the classical sense of the term. All believed, even a very radical popular rights activist also believed, that entire political order should evolve around the emperor, and emperor should be the sovereign head of the state. The year 1881 saw the peak of the popular rights movement in Japan, with thousands of deputations and thousands of enormous number of signatures reached the Meiji government in Tokyo in demand of a national assembly. When such things was going on, again Itagaki Taisuke played a very important role. The first political party in Japan came into existence under the leadership of Itagaki Taisuke, known as the Liberal Party of Japan or the JUTO. The JUTO was formed in October 1881. After a few months, in January 1882, another political party known as the Progressive Party of Japan or the Kaishinto had also been formed under the leadership of Okuma. Okuma was a person who was very vociferous for a national assembly and a constitution. But the Japanese emperor, along with his allies, had ousted Okuma from the government, and then Okuma had formed the Kaishinto or the Progressive Party of Japan. So far as political outlook was concerned, Kaishinto was much less radical than the JUTO. The Progressive Party or Kaishinto was not as radical as JUTO or the Liberal Party of Itagaki Taisuke. In fact, the two organizations held opposite and divergent views on many political issues. But these two political parties formed consensus on two issues. Number one, both the parties demanded a constitution and a national assembly. Number two, both the parties wanted that the emperor should be the sovereign head of the state and he should be treated as the symbol of unity and integrity of the Japanese state. The government response to the popular rights movement was twofold. First, the Japanese government or the Meiji government at the time enacted many repressive censorship laws to tackle the popular rights movements. The Act of 1874 was very severe, and this act was even reinforced in 1887, which went against the rights of the people. And the number two response was they agreed to give a constitution, but that should be a very conservative constitution, and a constitution must be formed which would ensure enormous power of the emperor and his associates and try to restrict the rights of the people as far as practicable. And this was the impact of the popular rights movement in Japan.
Yeah, I have just one question, that is, this popular right movements, how was it, how far was it spontaneous? Was it actually very spontaneous, or can we actually see it as a power play with the, of the government officials within the Meiji government, who the disgruntled officials coming out from the government and form demanding these rights as a way of trapping the government, maybe leading them to trouble? Or was it very spontaneous?
No, definitely the movements were very spontaneous at the local level. The men who came out of the government, they just took the opportunity and utilized the situation. The political situation was very rife, but I have already told that the supporters of the popular rights movement or the popular rights activists, their number was very limited. But those who tried, they formed journals, They formed many associations, they published journals, they held rallies, they did many things spontaneously. And these leaders whom I have named, they came just to take advantage of the situation and to crystallize the movement. It was a two-way traffic, both-way traffic. Ito Hirobumi, a very important Chosu leader and the most important member of the Meiji government, was entrusted with the responsibility of framing a constitution. Ito Hirobumi traveled extensively in Europe in 1882. He had to gather knowledge, acquire knowledge about the functioning of the constitutions of several Western countries. But he stayed in Germany for a long time. In fact, the conservative personality of the German Chancellor Bismarck impressed him very much. He had further been impressed by the very conservative nature of the German constitution. Furthermore, another person, Hermann Roessler, a professor of law in Germany, had become the advisor to the Japanese army. This Hermann Roessler played an important role in framing the Meiji constitution. So, it was clear that the Meiji constitution would be a conservative constitution. And Richard Story, one of the most outstanding historians on Far East, in his History of Japan, tells that the Meiji constitution was framed by men of strongly authoritarian turn of mind. They had only one aim. What was that aim? They wanted to give emperor the most important power. They ignored all other aspects of an independent constitution. Ito Hirobumi returned to Japan in 1884 and he began to take elementary steps for adopting a new constitution. In 1885, a cabinet had been formed and Ito became the Prime Minister of Japan. The constitution was drafted very secretly in 1886 and 1887. In 1888, a new body called Privy Council had been formed. The Privy Council was entrusted with the duty of discussing the constitution and to see that it should ensure the rights of the emperor and the administrators. Ito Hirobumi became the president of the Privy Council and Kuroda became the new prime minister. On 11th February 1889, Emperor Meiji handed the constitution to the Prime Minister Kuroda in a brief but solemn ceremony. It was a very important aspect of Japanese history. As the emperor handed the constitution to Kuroda, it was clear that it was a gift from the emperor to the Japanese subjects. It was not a culmination of the popular demand of the Japanese people. The Articles 1 to 17 elaborate and define the power of the emperor. These articles categorically stated that emperor was the supreme head of the Japanese state. He was the person who could recruit and dismiss the important government officials, ministers, and the high post men in the army and the navy. He was the supreme head of the army and the navy. Not only that, he had the power to seek judges to give verdict according to his own will. The emperor was the man who could sue for peace or declare war with the other countries, and he was the man who was the supreme head of the foreign affairs. Theoretically, it had also been stated that the emperor was the head of the executive, legislature, and the judiciary. In fact, the Meiji Constitution had been adopted just a century after the French Revolution. But the theory of separation of power, the principle of separation of power, very little impressed the architects of the Meiji Constitution. But the king was debarred from one important right. The emperor had very little economic right. He could not bring about any changes in the tax structure of the country. He could not even impose any new tax on the citizens. He had not the power to amend the constitution also. He could raise certain proposals, he could give certain proposals, and it was up to the National Assembly or the Diet to accept it or not. It was the power and function of the emperor. Then, the articles between 18 and 32 spell about the rights and duties of the Japanese subjects. The constitution recognized certain rights of the Japanese people, equal opportunity for getting government and non-government jobs, getting jobs in army and the navy. It recognized the liberty of association and expression. It also gave right to property to the every Japanese citizens, and it was also guaranteed that unless one agreed, his house could not be ransacked by the police or state military forces. And right to religion had also been accepted in this constitution. But at the end of it, in a separate article, by inserting a separate article, it was clearly stated that all these rights had been made conditional by the limits of law. What does it mean? It means that the state could easily violate these rights at will, because everything was made conditional by the limits of law. Furthermore, it was categorically stated that in time of war or in time of national emergency, the emperor was at liberty to violate any rights of the people for seeking protection of the nation. So, these rights were never treated as fundamental rights or inviolable rights. These rights were given by the mercy of the emperor, and the emperor could violate these rights when emperor felt that for the necessity of the integrity, unity and security of the country, these rights could be curtailed, restricted. So far as duties of the citizens were concerned, two things were inserted. Citizens had to pay taxes regularly and they had to join the army at call of the state. These two duties were just elaborated in these articles between 18 and 32. The articles between 33 and 54 were very important articles which dealt with the power and functions of the National Assembly. The National Assembly or the representative body was called the Imperial Diet. The Imperial Diet was a bicameral legislature. The upper house was called the House of Peers and the lower house was called the House of Representatives. The upper house comprised of highest taxpayers in the country, old feudal aristocrats and oligarchs, and some nominees of the emperor. In fact, this composition of the upper house amply reflects the class character of the upper house. And this upper house in the Japanese constitution was extremely powerful. It had the right to reject any law promulgated by the lower house or the House of Representatives. If the lower house or the House of Representatives would enact any law that would have been inimical to the class interest of the members of the upper house, they could at will reject or even nullify that law. They were highly, extremely powerful, the members, and the upper house was highly powerful. In that sense, it was not like the House of Lords in Great Britain. It was a very powerful body, the House of Peers in Japan. The upper house had 368 members, whereas the lower house or the House of Representatives had 379 members, and all the members of the lower house or the House of Representatives were elected members. They were elected by the people, but remember, they were not elected by the universal adult franchise, nor even by universal male franchise. The elections had been held just on the basis of property. So, as a result of which only 1% of the entire Japanese population secured the right to vote. Why this was done? Because the ruling oligarchy of Japan wanted to restrict the franchise as far as practicable so that they could hold the control over every aspect of the state, every political affairs of the state. But the Diet had one important power, that is, they could negate the budget, reject the budget if the members of the Diet felt. When the budget was proposed, the members of the Diet had the right to apply a veto and reject the budget. If the budget had been rejected, the old budget of the previous year should have continued. It was a very important right that the members of the house, they felt. It was declared that the Diet was empowered to legislate, but there was also one thing which bore the authority of the emperor. That was a legislation must entail the sanctioning signature of the emperor. If there was no sanctioning signature of the emperor, a bill could not be enacted in Meiji Japan, and it was another significant feature of the Meiji Constitution. Article 55 Meiji Constitution, it just elaborated and defined the activities and functions of the ministers. In the Meiji Constitution, the term cabinet had not been used. Instead, the term Council of Ministers had been used. But it was clearly stated that Council of Ministers should not be the representatives of the people. They should be nominated by the emperor. So it was clear that the ministers remained responsible not to the Diet or the National Assembly. They remained responsible only to the emperor. So these features of the Meiji Constitution clearly reveal that the structure, the features, traits of the Meiji Constitution was extremely conservative, and it was absolutely authoritarian in nature. It was in replete with, the Meiji Constitution of 1889 was replete with pitfalls and limitations. But despite such pitfalls and limitations, the Meiji Constitution marked the beginning of a democratic process in Japan. But the fundamentals of democracy in Japan was so weak that the Meiji Constitution failed to emerge as a democratic constitution in a real sense of the term. Extensive powers given to the House of Peers proved that the Meiji Constitution was designed to protect the class interest of the industrialists and the old aristocracy. According to John Halliday, a very important historian, his book, A Political History of Japanese Capitalism, John Halliday wrote that The constitution ensured the tyrannical measures of the state in favor of property. So we may conclude by quoting Nathaniel Pfeffer, with a constitution, a cabinet, a diet, and all the trappings of the 19th century government, Japan still remained a feudal oligarchy.
So what the industrial class of Japan, were they emerging from the feudal aristocratic class, or had they emerged separately?
No, they emerged from the feudal aristocratic class. In fact, if you go through the history of the Meiji Restoration, you would see that one of the important causes of the Meiji Restoration was dire economic crisis in Japan. And when there was a decline of the old feudal lords called samurai, warrior class, and the daimyo, big feudal lords, there was a decline. They had very little economic opportunity. Then a group of the old feudal class chose to trade, and a new group of traders called chonin emerged in Japan just prior to the Meiji Restoration. They had accumulated enormous amount of capital through trading and business. And after the Meiji Restoration, with the active assistance of the Meiji government and the bankers, they got money, they invested it in the industries. And primarily, the Meiji industry developed through state enterprise, particularly the cotton industry, railway industry, so on and so forth. But after the 1880s, the Meiji government began to leave their responsibility, quit responsibility, and they just helped the capitalist class by easing government loans and giving many tax facilities and other things. And they were definitely a part of the old feudal class. There was no independent emergence of the, they were the part of the old, particularly the samurai class. When war ended, the samurai class, the old warrior class, lost their profession. They had no work, but they had to do something. They came into business and industry. I have at first stated the background of the popular rights movement in Japan. Then I highlighted the Satsuma revolt, a reactionary movement that took place against the new regime. And simultaneously with the new regime, a progressive kind of movement, that is the popular rights movement, also took place in Japan, which compelled the Meiji government to concede to the demand of a national assembly and a constitution. And at last, I have given the features of the constitution and several articles of the constitution, which was definitely a conservative constitution. And the constitution, in fact, evolved the power of the emperor, and emperor had been given the supreme and sovereign place in the constitution, and thus people's rights had been restricted and curtailed in the Meiji constitution.